selected some quotations for us that demonstrate that the struggle for people of color to speak for themselves in media has been an everlasting struggle almost as old and older than our country. So we've asked Joe's friend, Chance Williams, to read these quotes for us, who is himself a wonderful media advocate. Chance.
Thank you. From the founders of Freedom's Journal, the first African-American-owned newspaper in the United States, which began publishing weekly in 1827. We wish to plead our own cause. Too long have others spoken for us. From the press and the pulpit, we have suffered much by being incorrectly represented. From journalist Ruben Salazar's plea to media executives at the Chicano Media Council Conference in 1970. We ask you, almost beg you, to help us inform this nation about the tragic plight of 8 million invisible Chicanos whose lives often parallel those of black people. There's much bitterness in our Mexican-American community, gentlemen, an ever-increasing bitterness against school systems that psychologically mutilate the Chicano child, against certain police who habitually harass our brown brothers, against local and federal governments that apparently respond only to violence. Consequently, there are some Chicanos who have finally concluded that we must have a Watts-type riot to catch your attention, to force the establishment to pay heed. We prayerfully hope this won't happen. We hope that reason will finally prevail, that you leaders of the national media will help us to push for the kinds of governmental reforms and changes in public attitudes that will help better the lot of the much ignored Chicano. In all candor, gentlemen, I can't say I'm entirely hopeful. It may be too late to forestall the violence of long festering frustration, but I think we should try. Salazar's warning proved tragically prophetic. A few weeks later, on August 29th, 1970, he was killed when a tear gas projectile fired by a police officer struck him in the head when an anti-war protest he was covering turned into a riot. And finally, from Patrice Cullors, one of the founders of the Black Lives Matter movement, the words of the past echo today. The internet is the most democratic communication platform in history, largely because we've had network neutrality rules that make sure all web traffic is treated equally and no voices are discriminated against. Because of network neutrality rules, activists can turn to the internet to bypass the discrimination of mainstream cable, broadcast, and print outlets as we organize for change. It is because of net neutrality rules that the internet is the only communication channel left where black voices can speak and be heard, produce and consume on our own terms.
Thanks, Chance. So now we're so delighted to honor Joe Torres. At the start of his career, Joe spent 7 years as a journalist. He served at Staten Island Advance, covering local news. He served at a weekly covering Latino political issues. And then he went on to serve as the deputy director of the National Association of Hispanic Journalists. At NAHJ, he helped to supervise a series of reports, brownouts, reports that demonstrated that fewer than 1% of the stories covered in the network media covered Latinos, and when they did appear, they were portrayed stereotypically. Joe was responsible also for NAHJ taking on media policy advocacy as part of its DNA to find ways to benefit both Latino journalists and the Latino community. He finds time, in addition to all that, because now he serves as the executive director for external affairs for Free Press, our good allies for all here today, and besides that, serves on the board for the Center for Media Justice and the National Association of Latino Independent Producers. And those of you who've been coming for a few years, remember that we recognized Malkia Soro from CMJ a couple of years ago. So Joe has made a major contribution to the cause of media justice. He wrote with Juan Gonzalez. 8 years he spent researching and writing a best-selling book called News for All the People, the epic story of race and the American media. And it tells the story of how the American media covered people of color from colonial times to the age of the internet, and it chronicles how people of color tried to find ways to tell their own stories. And as one reviewer noted, these are the stories that seldom, if ever, get told in the sweep of media history in this country. Now, perhaps because he spent so much time documenting this history, Joe cannot remain quiet that he sees the same thing happening on our watch today, whether it involves people of color, or women, or members of the LGBTQ community. Sometimes Joe feels compelled to say things, even to our good friends that are difficult. But sometimes good friends have to have difficult conversations. And we are grateful to Joe for keeping us honest, keeping us focused on those difficult conversations, and keeping us focused on the most important difficult conversations. Most of all, our honorary committee was so impressed with Joe's ability to work behind the scenes when he doesn't take credit to make sure that the media reform movement, the media justice movement does not lose its fire, and that voices of people who are otherwise marginalized are heard speaking for themselves. He is an ally behind the scenes when one is needed, and he stands up to speak out when no one else will. Joe's passion means that his allies and friends, and even his opponents all across the city, know that Joe is going to reach out and make an effort. Everybody respects him. He tries to bring people together. But, like Everett Parker before him, he will not be silent in the face of injustice. So it is our immense honor to give this year's Parker Award to Joseph A. Torres.
Voices are heard in the media. It is why we created our own newspapers 200 years ago, and why we go online today. But it has never been in the interest of those in power to allow our voices to speak or be heard. It wasn't in Jackson, Mississippi, during the 1960s, when Dr. Parker and Black local civil rights leaders challenged the TV license of WLBT, a racist station that used the public airwaves to prevent integration in order to preserve a separate and unequal society. At the time, U.S. citizens didn't have the legal right to challenge the broadcast license, even when one of those stations was run by a white supremacist. But the UCC lawsuit changed history when a federal court ruled that everyday people could challenge FCC policy. This unleashed a new era of media activism. Black and brown civil rights leaders demanded that broadcasters hire people of color and air programs that informed rather than demonized their communities. From 1971 to 1973, more than 340 license challenges were filed mainly by civil rights groups. This uprising forced the industry to hire the first wave of journalists of color to integrate our nation's newsrooms. But 40 years later, it is easy to be discouraged by the lack of progress. There are too few journalists of color working in newsrooms today, and it's too much media coverage that marginalizes our community. Because throughout history, people of color have always been covered as a threat to society. Back in the 1700s, the Colonial Boston Newsletter wrote that blacks were addicted to stealing a line. In 2011, a Pew report of the Pittsburgh media market found that of the nearly 5,000 stories studied in both print and broadcast, less than 4% featured an African-American male engaged in a subject other than crime or sports. That's probably true in most other cities as well. As the journalist Stacey Packer recently said, the American media, the, the, mainstream media is working exactly the way it should. A racist society requires media bias. A racist society requires coverage of people of color that aligns and overlaps with border racist sentiments and stereotypes. The struggle for racial justice is very much dependent on access to the media so we can tell our own stories. But this is hard to do when you're dependent on corporate gatekeepers to tell your story. When people of color own a few broadcast stations and cable outlets. When our nation's media policies are shaped by structural racism. This is why the fight over the future of the open internet, over net neutrality, is so central to the struggle for racial justice. It has provided the digital oxygen that has helped to bring life into the movement that cries out Black Lives Matter, not one more, say her name. But while the internet can be a tool to fight for liberation, we know it can also be used for a tool for our own oppression through mass government surveillance and corporate surveillance. But we are able to fight back today because Dr. Parker and Black leaders fought in Jackson to show our voices for silence. We're able to fight because Al Kramer of the Citizens Communication Center worked with the community to force broadcasters to hire people of color. We're able to fight because William Wright of Black Efforts for Solar Television organized the Black community to stand up to institutional racism in the media. We're able to fight back because Emma Bowen was troubled by the impact of the media on the Black community and found Black citizens for a fair media. We're able to fight back because journalists like Juan Gonzalez and Charlie Erickson, both close friends of mine and mentors, have exposed the media bias that is harming the Latino community. And we're able to fight back today because a new generation of activists are demanding a just media system that assures broadband is an affordable lifeline, fighting against predatory prison phone rates, against the targeted surveillance of communities of color simply because they are not white, for an open internet that allows our voices to be heard and never silenced, and for journalism that seeks to expose institutional racism rather than protect it. This is why I am honored to receive this award. It validates that we are on the right path as so many have fought so hard for us to walk on. I want to thank my Free Press family for giving me the opportunity to be part of this noble struggle, especially Craig Aaron, Kimberly Lockie, Matt Wood, and Misty Perez-Trues. I also want to thank my Media Justice and Civil Rights family, Makia Cyril, Stephen Renderos, Randy Collins, Rashad Robinson, James Rutter, Jessica Gonzalez, Michael Scott, Alex McAllis, and so many others for allowing me to lock arms with them in service to this struggle. Because in order to achieve racial justice, we must have a media system that is just. I also want to thank my family and my wife for all their support. I especially want to thank my wonderful daughter, Deb Karras. I'm a little tired, so sorry for being a little emotional up here. I am so proud to receive this honor alongside a Wally woman who has fought to ensure that people of color have access to modern telecommunications regardless of where they live or how much they make. Finally, I want to take a chance to fly in. And I want to thank Cheryl Anza and the United Church of Christ and the selection committee for believing I'm worthy of this recognition. Rest in power, Everett Parker. Thanks.